Well, I'm going to switch to the computer and to the computer screen and show you a bunch of linear regulators and explain how we could use these to build a sort of charger for these supercapacitors. So we're back at the computer and it's time to search for a linear regulator that will be able to charge our battery. Now again, just a small refresher. Usually supercapacitors are available in various voltage ratings. We have 2.3 volts, 2.5 and 2.7. These are the most common voltages for supercapacitors. So if we plan to charge the battery from USB, which is 5 volts, we can use basically any low drop linear regulator to output these values. Most linear voltage regulators have certain voltage drop. Basically, they need a few volts above the output voltage to provide a stable output voltage. The cheapest voltage regulators need about 2 volts, and there are a bit more expensive voltage regulators that only need about 1.2 volts. If we plan to use a single supercapacitor I currently use in the battery that I just built on the workbench, we can use basically any voltage regulator. As I noted here, for example, let's see the classical LM317, which is a very simple three-terminal adjustable regulator. As you can see, it has an output current greater than 1.5 amps, and it can be adjusted. It's adjustable from 125 volts to 37 volts, and it's basically super easy to use. As I'm going down to a typical application circuit, you can see here that it only needs two resistors and maybe a diode and a capacitor, but these are optional basically. But the problem changes a bit if we plan to use two supercapacitors. Depending on what supercapacitors we're going to choose, we're going to have up to 4.65 volts and a bit more, but we won't be able to charge such supercapacitors to the maximum because LT1307 has a 5 volt input limit. As you saw when I showed you the datasheet for that for the LT1307. So we need a voltage regulator that's a bit more has a bit more performance. And I went and searched for such a linear regulator and found this IC made by Micrel, MIC2941. So this MIC2941, as you can see here described, it has a very low dropout voltage, 40 millivolts at lo light loads. So basically it has a dropout voltage of 0.04 volts, a dropout voltage at light loads, and about 0.35 volts at 1 amp. And it can output 125 amps of current. So it seems like an excellent IC to use, because we would be able to output from 5 volts 4.6 volts. And since it has only about 0.04 volts at light loads, we may be able to get very close to 5 volts. And let's scroll down to the graphs. So when the supercapacitors will be discharged completely, the current will be very high at 125 volts. So we could set this linear regulator to accept 5 volts input and output let's say 4.95 volts. Now at at high current at 125 amps, there will be a voltage drop of about 400 millivolts. So this linear regulator will not be able to output 495 volts, but it will be able to get up to, let's say, 4.6 volts at 125 amps. But as the supercapacitors are charging within a few seconds, the current demand will slowly go down, and the voltage, the dropout voltage will no longer be 400 volts, but it will be 300, 200. Output voltage will slowly go up to about 4.7, 4.8, and so on. It will slowly go up to about 495 volts. Such a linear regulator would seem excellent for charging our supercapacitors to, well, we could basically set the output voltage to 5 volts, and even though the with 5 volts at the input, the linear regulator will never be able to achieve 5 volts because it has that 0.04 volts dropout voltage, we won't care about it because the supercapacitors will be charged in about 20 seconds. So we just count to 10 or to 20 and just pull out the charger and we're done. Now, you may think that setting it to 5 volts output when the input is only 5 volts would make the linear regulator unstable. But in reality, this doesn't really happen. As you can see in this other graph here, there is basically a linear dependence between the output voltage and the input voltage. Even at 5 milliamps load or at 125 amps load, if we give it let's say 3 volts at the input and we set this voltage regulator to 5 volts, we're not going to get 5 volts, but at the same time it's not going to be unstable. It will basically output around 3 volts. Now, in this particular case, I don't have this MIC2941 in stock. I do have this LM2941, which is the same chip more or less, but it's manufactured by Texas Instruments. However, there is a quirk about this chip. It can only output from 5 volts to 20 volts. I'm not sure why that is. This micro-L part can output as low as 125 volts, not a problem. There is an example. You can see that it has 1.2 volts to 26 volts without a problem in the adjustable regulator application note here. But this particular one from Texas Instruments can only do up from 5 volts to 20 volts. Otherwise, this LM2941, which is a bit cheaper, is just a bit weaker. At 1 amp, it needs 0.5 volts. But just like with the micro-L part, as the current is no longer high, the dropout voltage goes down to about 0.1 and less. Now, since I only have one supercapacitor connected right now at the battery, I'm basically interested in using a cheaper and easier to use linear regulator, such as LM317. But we also have that problem about limiting the current going to the supercapacitor when it's fully discharged. As you noticed a few minutes ago, when the supercapacitors are fully discharged, they're going to be taking 2.5 amps from the power supply, which is a bit bad if we try to charge from, let's say, from the computer. We should have a sort of mechanism to limit the current to a more reasonable value of, let's say, 1 amp of current, or about 1.5. Now, we could do it easily using such a linear regulator, and we even have here in this datasheet an example. Here we go, precision current limiter circuit. So by using this LM317 with a simple resistor, we have here the formula. The limit is set by this formula. So if we want about 1 amp of current, we should have a 1.2 ohm resistor. And the power dissipation in the resistor is basically the current times, if I remember correctly, is times the resistance. So it will be about 1.2 watts dissipated in the resistor. But I'm not sure, I'll have to double check this. So this would be a basic current limiting circuit, but besides limiting this current, we would also have to have a second linear regulator to regulate the voltage from, let's say, 5 volts to 2.69 or 2.49 or 2.28-29 volts, so that we won't damage the supercapacitors. We basically have now two parts, and it's more expensive. Let's try to make it very cheap and very, very small. Basically, almost all linear regulators, all modern ones, have some sort of current limiting. Some sort of protections, they won't burn up, they just shut down. As you can see, this one has on-chip current limiting, but if I remember correctly, this one has about 2-2.5 amps of current limit, which is a bit more. We want to have it at about 1-1.5 amps. We want the limit set about to about this value. So this LM317 would not be a good regulator for limiting to some safe values. So I went and looked around the DigiKey and searched through several such regulators and found this particular one, which is again a very classic, very common part. As you can see, if we search for 1117 in this category, we're going to find 1157 regulators with the 1117 code in them, in their name. So as you can see, it's a very, very classic, common, easy to find part. Let's see, adjustable. And now we're down to about 50 parts. And we can see here TLV-1117, NCP-1117, and basically a lot of parts. So I'm just going to show you the datasheet, which is basically LD-1117. And this particular one has a smaller output current, up to 800 milliamps. It's just as easily to use in adjustable form, and available in various packages. And it has an internal current and thermal limit. So if we go down and to the characteristics for the adjustable version, as you can see here, adjustable, we can see that it has output current, a typical value of 950 milliamps, and a maximum of about 1.3 amps, 1300 milliamps. So we can estimate that there is a current limit to about maybe a bit higher than 1.3 amps, which, as we wanted 1.5 amps, is perfect. So the charger I'm going to make will have such LD-1117 IC, because I have it, I already bought one, so it's not a problem to use it. And we have here the adjustable output voltage application, a typical circuit. And just like with LT1307, we simply have to pick two resistors and to get the output voltage we want. That's about it. Let's go back to the workbench and build this charger and see how it will be behave when limiting current. So here you are back at the workbench. It's another day. I took a break yesterday from working. So here we have the charger already built up. Let me zoom a bit. So 270 ohm resistors and one 120 ohm resistor, the LD1117, two capacitors. And here we have the connector, which basically just two pins are used, but I've used a large one because it's keyed. The first pin is ground, the third one is the voltage. So here we have the battery, our fake battery, and I've installed a connector on the end of the wires, and we have the ground and the input voltage. So we can just put it inside, and if we put it the other way around, the voltage, input voltage, it's still in the center, but the ground pin is not connected, so it will not work. So we can safely connect it to the charger in only one position. Now, at the input we have a simple USB cable. I took a cable from my box and cut one end. So as you can see, it's, and here is just for so that it won't break the wires. It's just wired to the board a bit for more strength. And on this end, you see two wires. It's basically just soldered at the ground and the input, so that I can power it from the power supply, which will allow me to see how much current the battery will take from the power supply when charging, just to see if we actually managed to see if the LD1117 will actually limit the current to about 1 amp, 1.5 amps, as we intended to have it behave. So just to be extra sure, let me zoom out a bit. Here's the multimeter again, and I'm going to measure the output voltage. Right now the charger receives 5.1 volts from the power supply, as you can see in the background. So we put the probes on the ground and the output pin, and you can see that the voltage, I was very lucky that the resistors have are only 5% accurate, and the ratio turned out to be very close to 2.7 volts. So as you can see, 2.686 volts, which is great. It's just a bit below the supercapacitor voltage. Now, of course, the supercapacitor says in the datasheet that it can tolerate up to 3 volts for short periods of time, but it's better to be safe than sorry. So 2.685 is perfect. So now let's... the supercapacitor is discharged about 0.8 volts. When it's just this amount of charge, when it has just this amount of charge, it should still pull about 2 amps from the power supply for short periods of time. I'm just going to switch the power supply to show current, as you can see in the background, and I'm going to connect the battery to our charger, and let's see how much current it's going to take now. So as you can see, the linear regulator limits the current to 0.92 volts. And now we should be able to see the output voltage on the supercapacitor, which is slowly charging. As you can see, it's already to 2 volts. And now the linear regulator already is no longer current limited to 0.92, as you saw before, but it should slowly go down, as you can see. So as you can see, in just about 20-30 seconds, our supercapacitor is fully charged. And now the linear regulator only takes about 50 milliamps from the power supply. Now, you may notice that I've turned the supercapacitor around on this battery, and I'm going to show you why. Yesterday afternoon, after recording the previous segment where I showed you how to select the linear regulator, I actually tried to install this battery, this fake battery, in the charger, and I managed to do it, but I was not able to. Let me turn it off, and while talking I will remove the back panel. So I wasn't able to insert the battery with the supercapacitor placed horizontally. It's just a case of measure twice, measure several times, cut once, as the expression goes. It turns out that the supercapacitor is just about 1 millimeter larger in width than the compartment for the battery. As you can see, let me see if I can zoom it just a bit more. So as you can see, the panel comes out and the battery is in a small compartment here. Now this is not a problem. The problem is just that the battery is locked in place by those plastic separators, so it will stay in place. As you can see, I'm moving it and it won't come out. And there's a small I don't know that English term, I'm sorry, rubber to keep the battery from shaking around. Now the problem is that the supercapacitor in width is just a bit larger than this plastic, than the width, the distance between these two plastic walls. So I wasn't able to put this battery inside with the supercapacitor placed horizontally, but I was able to turn it around and put it inside like this. And as you can see, it will actually fit with a bit of effort, removing this pink red stuff. And I'm just going to carefully insert this. I'm just going to insert this first, and then I'm going to insert the battery. So anyway, the idea is that it will fit and it will stay inside. And I was able to, as you can see here, it fits and it stays inside. But the problem is, so I was able to connect it and put it inside and use the multimeter, but no, it's just not making contact right now, proper contact. So as you can see, it works just fine. Right now the battery is set to output 5.7 volts, and this multimeter shows low battery voltage at 5.5. So I just raised a bit the voltage so that it will account for that 50 millivolts ripple. So not a problem, it works, it shows, it measures correctly, and so on. But the problem is that due to soldering on let me carefully remove the battery now. Here we go. So the problem is that due to soldering, I was a bit excessive with the solder. Due to soldering, the the total height of the battery with these extension boards and the soldering and the leads in the back, it's basically a couple of millimeters or 3 millimeters too high. So this wouldn't be a problem with a final product, with an end product which would be much smaller, because we would use SOIC chip, and as you can see, the inductor stays vertical, while it could stay horizontal on a final product. And we could lower this board, or we could simply use ceramic capacitors and ceramic resistors and a smaller trim pot, which would all stay on the board below, so height wouldn't be an issue with a final product. This doesn't mean this is a failure. It's just that it's a bit too high right as it is right now, so I wasn't able to screw this panel completely closed. The leads here are not really a problem. They're very small, so we could just cut a very small groove somewhere around here, or simply screw in the back, cut a small hole, and it's really not a problem. It would defeat the purpose of this double insulation a bit, but since I'm not using this multimeter for high voltage purposes, it's not a problem. So even though as it is right now, I can't use it in the multimeter because it's a bit too high, I could basically just file it down and make it smaller. I consider this a success. I was able to keep the multimeter powered with just this 25 farad supercapacitor. I had a test last night, and the multimeter actually stayed powered and measuring correctly for 1 hour and 10 minutes. At about 1 hour and 15 minutes, it just stopped, because the DC-DC converter the output was about 3 volts, and it just shut down directly. So I'm happy with the result, and just in case someone wants to replicate this, this 25 farad supercapacitor is 16 millimeters in diameter and 26 millimeters in length. So 26 and 16. So if someone would, I would probably go for a supercapacitor with lower capacitance, now that I know that this multimeter would run for more than an hour with just 25 farads. And if you pick one that has a length that's less than 25 millimeters, this would actually fit like this. And you would actually perhaps fit two supercapacitors easily here. Especially if you... there are 15 farads or 18 farad capacitors, so a bit less, but at 10 millimeters in diameter. So it would actually fit two of these here easily, not a problem, since this is 26 millimeters in length, and it fits right now in the battery compartment, as you can see, by removing this stuff that was here. So you may not have this plastic, this rubber in your multimeter. So anyway, 20 millimeters, it's really no problem. So you could fit two 10 millimeter supercapacitors on the width of this fake battery. One thing that I forgot to mention is the price factor. A regular battery like this one would cost you about $2 or $3, but this is a bit more expensive. The LT1307 is about $4 or $5 in one piece quantity. If you buy about 10, it gets cheaper. Supercapacitor is about $6 or $7, so if you buy two, it will cost you a bit more, at about $10 or $15. And all the other parts are about $1, $1.5. This 9-volt connector, the trim pot is about 30 cents. And the rest is the inductor is about 25-50 cents. As it's a high performance one, surface mount stuff. Basically, everything is a bit expensive in if you buy just one piece, but if you plan to make several of them, it gets much cheaper. So, is it worth it? Absolutely. It's about $10-$15 to make this 9-volt battery, but considering you charge it in about 20 seconds, lasts you an hour, you can recharge it hundreds and of thousands of times without any problem. Supercapacitors don't go bad from recharging compared to a rechargeable battery, which only lasts about 1,000 charges and takes hours to charge. It's really worth building such a circuit, such as fake 9-volt battery. So I'm very pleased with the outcome of this project. I'm planning to build to custom make a PCB that would allow me to use the SoIC version of the chip and use only surface mounted components. This way I'll also be able to shield the all the circuitry under a copper foil to protect it from EMI and protect the multimeter from potential interference from the circuit, and that will also allow me to put a supercapacitor with a smaller diameter on top of the whole circuit that will be under the copper foil, protected, insulated by from everything. So by ordering a custom PCB, basically you can get you can make using open source software and send a design to a PCB manufacturer, and you can get a PCB for about you can get three or five small PCBs for about $5-$10. So it's really not a big investment. It will be much much more professional looking, and it will probably work a bit better. And will since I will be able to fit two or three supercapacitors that will be just a slightly smaller diameter or just a bit less tall, it will have an even longer lifetime, even more than 1 hour of lifetime. So I want to thank you for watching this long video. Hopefully it motivates you into making such a fake 9-volt battery. It's a nice project. And if you're watching this on YouTube, if you want, you can subscribe to this channel. I'm going to post similar videos in the future.